Thank you for listening to the OSWtv podcast. It is, of course, hosted by myself, Billy. This is a special edition of the OSWtv podcast. It is not with my comrade and cohort, Kevin. We are planning to do some recording in the next week or so to talk about rock and wrestle, and I've got some audio from that, but from Steve Robertson and also Bobby Roberts. So I can't wait to get that out to you guys. In the meantime, though, I phoned up Rawlins and Mikey of Reckless Intent, as they've got Over the Top on November 1st at the Moorstown Scout Hall, and we just started chatting about Over the Top and just about the wrestling world in general, and we ended up chatting along for a good 15 minutes or so, and I recorded it on this handy little microphone here. I will pre-warn you, it is recording a telephone conversation, so it does dip in quality, but from the conversation that I had with Mikey and Rawlins, it is definitely worth listening to. So enjoy the OSWtv podcast, and if you enjoyed it, share it, like it, tell your friends, and I hope to do more in the future. But in the meantime, X-Men, play me in.
They call themselves the Guardians of the Galaxy.
What a bunch of a-holes.
Well, I tried to keep it clean, but I fucked that up about 50 minutes into my first podcast, so, yeah, you can swear, keep it in moderation, but yeah.
No, that's okay for us, because, like, we're not a PG product, but, you know, we don't overly swear, but I think we draw the line about bits and bitch, so we're more, it's family-friendly product, but it's a little bit more edgy, so that people aren't having their intelligence insulted.
Yes, that's fine.
Mr. Badman.
Yes, swearing's fine. As I said, yeah, I tried to keep it in moderation now, but I screwed that up in our first podcast, so I've just kind of just relaxed a little bit, because otherwise, if I say I'm not going to swear, you end up swearing. That's how it goes. So we'll speak about Over the Top, and then we'll just take it from there, because Over the Top is your biggest event of the year.
Not biggest of the year, but biggest to date.
It is our biggest to date. It's the first one we're doing in a venue where we're looking to try and draw a lot bigger crowd than what we get in the unit.
So the unit, how many usually does it hold?
Between 10 and 100 people in the unit.
Right, so what's the scout hall going to be like?
We're looking at 200. But we won't really know exactly how many we can hold in it until we're all set up, because we've never actually set up in there and kind of seen the space that we've got. So Saturday's going to be a complete learning curve for us, so we'll know exactly more once we've done the scout hall, what the exact capacity and things are. We've put it down that the capacity is 200, but I wouldn't be surprised if we could actually get more in the scout hall.
Yeah, based on any kind of external stuff we've done before, and public events where we've been booked at, you know, and you've got several hundred people standing watching you. I think last year at Party in the Park, we had a head count of about 380 at one point.
Wow. So this will be a new experience for your trainees and that as well, won't it? Because they'll be used to it.
This show has kind of been 2 years in the making. The Reckless Intent first became a company August 2012, and that's where we all kind of started putting the plans in place. Like, where would we hope to do a show? Muirstown Scout Hall was one of the first places that me and Sean and a couple other guys involved at the time discussed. It was like, we're going to do Muirstown Scout Hall. So this show has essentially been 2 years in the making. We didn't want to just rush into doing a big venue and then sit in a big venue with nobody there. So it's kind of, we've took our time over the last year. The last year has kind of been a big turning point for us. So we're now looking to draw a good crowd on Saturday. Fingers crossed that's what we get.
Yeah, it's kind of that trial and error thing, you know. We've kind of spent the last few years trying to build an audience and build our fan base, build the product. You know, because we've had the... because we've had the experience of working with other companies and seeing it at its worst, you know, when there's 10, 15 people out in the seats and you're going out there and performing either way, we didn't want to duplicate those mistakes that other people had made.
From my experience, as soon as, I think it was John that came up to me originally about Reckless Intent, an SWE show, and since I started speaking about it, I can tell you guys have so many loyal fans that that just follow it religiously, and you're exactly right, 2 years in the making, and you've built up that fan base, and you can see by the pictures that are online of the unit every month, every event, it's always packed, so expanding is probably...
What we found when we first opened, it wasn't wrestling fans that we were attracting, it was just people that were fans of us, and they came and they became fans of the product, so they were not necessarily fans of WWE, TNA, or they never even really knew that there was any wrestling kind of locally going on in Scotland, so they were essentially, they got wrestling fans and they became fans of our product, so they became Reckless Intent fans. We've kind of built on that, in building people as Reckless Intent fans, rather than your generic wrestling fan, if you know what I mean. Yeah, a handful of people that, you know, have came along with us from place to place, you know, friends that we've made over the years and places that we've worked that have, you know, that have also left the places that we've worked for whatever reason, that, you know, we all kind of clumped together as a group of friends, and those people kind of began as the first group of followers. Yeah, the kind of followers, the faithful, if you will.
Are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here. Sorry, you seemed to cut off there for a sec. I think we're all right. You're faithful fans. So for moving to the Scout Hall, then it's probably it was 2 years in the making. So it's a bit of a scary experience, seeing as you've packed out 80 to 100 folk. You're just hoping that it's more than 80 and 100 folk, obviously.
That same kind of faithful group of 80 to 100 that always come, they'll then be new interested parties from outside based on any advertising that we've done to pick up new stuff.
Yeah, we're finding regular now though, there's people travelling from all over the place to come to our shows in the little unit. There's people travelling from Glasgow, people from Dundee now as well, just all over the place, so it's good getting we're starting to attract fans from elsewhere, not just locally, I'm really happy that we've been able to do that.
Excellent, and I'm assuming, Dundee 1 will be obviously because of your connection with SWE.
We've also seemed to have kind of globbed on a little bit to some ICW fans. There's some ICW fans that have started becoming quite regular fans of our product. I think that's all a lot down to the way things are done on social media. A guy like St. George, who's on social media and he's everywhere and on everything, people start to question who is
that guy. He picks a fight with someone in every company and just gets as much heat and as much attention as possible.
Yeah, so I've noticed. anything that comes up in my Facebook feed with St. George, it's always him. As in trying to rile someone up, whether it be Julie Miller or Chaz Phoenix at the moment, that seems to be his favourite one. Yeah, he's going for.
He's two ones with Jam as well recently. They've been really funny.
Oh yeah, the wedding
match at Sunday Slam. Yeah, or a marriage.
But you're actually one of the very few companies that is. I mean, I'm on like all the Facebook pages for all of them, but Reckless Intent seems to be the one that really works hard. It's like every day there's always an update, a video, a promo, or something, just so it keeps it fresh and it keeps it up to date.
That's a learned behaviour out of watching the failures of others and trying not to duplicate them. It's like seeing someone going wrong here and then going, well, we're not going to do that, we will do this instead. And things like, you know, when we were coming up, we never saw any of our footage back because
those videos are yet to be uploaded, or, you know, they're only just starting to be uploaded now, and we're like, that's never going to be the way it is. If everything will be filmed and things will be uploaded, you know, as soon as they are rendered and
whatnot. Yeah, it helps people to follow what's going on. And again, it's important. I feel it's important that we have, like, continuous stories, and not just like a couple of stories going on. I feel like it's important that everybody has something, so that each match that goes on has its own importance. So, like, depending on who you're a fan of, what wrestler you follow, like, each match has got that little bit of meaning, because there's always something building to it for every person. And that to me, I think, is really important, because the fans then can follow everything that's going on. But social media is brilliant. It's because you're able to put everything up so quickly, instantly. So I've really made use of that over the last year or so.
Yeah, I mean, it does really bring penance to the, I mean, that, again, with St. George, that self-promotion through social media thing, you know, it can just gain so much interest so quickly from the littlest thing. Although I haven't really figured out how to use Twitter properly yet.
Twitter is just... the thing about, well, for me, Twitter, it's like, it's 104 characters. You need to get your stuff out, and that's it. It's not like you can't... put a whole 104 characters, you have to get your storyline across just like that, and that's it, out it goes. But with Facebook, it allows you to maybe tell a little bit more of the story, and
it's more of the story. I kind of play about with the Twitter posts every now and then. Like, sometimes I won't check Twitter for like 4 or 5 days, then I'll go on and go, shit, I need to check Twitter, and I'll check it, and I've got notifications on Twitter. It's one of those things I always forget to check. But when I'm maybe trying to promote a wrestler or one of our workers who has Twitter and regularly uses Twitter, for example, like Joe Hendry, I use it to promote these guys because they've got a following on these things. Mm-hmm. I think things will get seen more through Twitter if you're using guys who have got a following on these social network platforms. The majority of us were through Facebook, and we seem to be getting a lot of new likes every other day. That things are kind of pushing up pretty quickly, which I'm quite happy with.
Yeah, next stop, 1,000.
Yeah.
Jeez. Well, I mean, that's basically a testament to how strong the Scottish wrestling scene is at the moment. I mean, you see, I don't think I can think of any wrestling company pages that haven't got at least 500, 600 likes at the moment. So, I mean, the audience is just... It's there for the taking. I suppose it could be in part down to ICW, but without the guys coming to the shows, it's their word of mouth, really. This really, and your YouTube channels and your social media, that's really getting people to come. But so what are your thoughts on the current scene in Scotland and how it's steadily evolving?
You know, we were just discussing this the other day, and I genuinely believe that the Scottish wrestling... Well, actually, UK wrestling, but more so Scottish wrestling, is at the highest point that it's ever been. That's a lot down to ICW. The work that's went in there to that company is amazing, and like a lot of other companies should work, like, hope they emulate that kind of success with it, because they are massive. They're pushing on. If not, they're going to be the biggest promotion in Europe, I would say.
Yeah. I think they possibly already
are. Yeah. Not to take away from anybody else, you know, that's not favouring towards any one person. Everyone does their contribution, but I think having that stepping stone there has opened the gates for, you know, all of us.
Absolutely.
Scottish wrestling.
Yeah, without that insane Fight Club documentary, then it might not have been as popular than it is right now, and... Well, as you're saying, for working hard, it's like I've been to several shows and I've never seen them be relaxed. It's always everyone's working hard, pulling their weight, and I think that's the difference between like the Americans, like when WWE come over, you can see they're kind of just plodding through their moves, and then that's it, it's over. But when you go to local shows, Scottish shows, all the guys are there working hard to get the butts in seats and for them to. Then
for certain, but not to take away from what you're saying, but you know the Americans, you know, it's every single day for them going out there and wrestling every single day. And although
you know, most of us train every single day. We're not having the opportunity to go out there and perform every single day. So the opportunities that we do get, there's no holding back. You can't hold back, you know, because this is the time to shine, essentially.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, also mean this is when they come over here, this is our first chance to see them live, but then I've been to several WWE shows and they just seem to, like, go through the motions, which doesn't get people to come back. That's the thing. But when you see you guys and as I said, like our shows round about, you can see how hard they work, and that's why you keep coming back, to see them to perform to the best of their ability. So it's a true testament to Scottish wrestlers or local wrestlers, how hard they work to get the fans to come back. Whereas I would say the WWE guys don't have to work as hard because they've got the name branding behind it.
Yeah, no, certainly.
Yeah. I made a point eventually. It was a little bit stumbling, but yeah. Anyway, Over the Top's going to be your biggest, well, hopefully it's going to be your biggest show of the year or so far for Epic.
The Colt Cabana show was massive. I mean, like, how do we talk? Well, the Colt Cabana show for the summer from August. It was like, we need to get a bigger venue. So, like, everything from the Colt Cabana show has been building to get, let's get a bigger venue. We're at that point where we're ready. I feel we're ready to make that step to a new venue. Start pushing, and let's build an audience to try and double or get as big an audience as we possibly can. Cause I think, in West Lothian, I think we're ready. We're getting out there, and people are recognising us now. I think the opportunity is there to take through the Livingston and the West Lothian market for us, because our shows are very different from a lot of other. You get your generic run-of-the-mill family-friendly shows, and then happy clappy, and it's like, sit there and insult people's intelligence, but, you know, asking shall I before you hit a big move.
I see a few shows that are like, shall I hit him? Well, yeah.
my idea is putting a lot more of a hard hitting, realistic looking product. And I like to think that's what we're putting across to people from what they see our shows, specifically, the ICW fans that keep coming back to our shows. There must be something about our shows that they keep bringing them back.
These are people that are travelling from, you know, the furthest reaches of Glasgow and Hamilton and stuff like that. And, you know, I don't think I've ever set foot in these places, so, yeah.
Absolutely, mate.
There's always this guy that I'm looking for in the crowd. I think he lives in Elgin. I never see him there.
is that right? I've probably seen him around.
I can't remember what his name is. William or something.
That hurts. No, I am going to get down to Reckless at some point. Hopefully it will be in the new year. I live in on my own. Doesn't help. All the bills, all the kind of rubbish. It sucks. But no,
that one's awesome.
I need to get out to more shows down there. It doesn't help them, like, miles away, a fair bit away.
so many of these companies use social media for you to see them, don't
they? Exactly. So I can watch your shows on YouTube, but I don't think it's not quite the same as going to see it live. My personal opinion.
I'd like to think we've got quite a unique atmosphere, especially in the shows in the unit, because the atmosphere is so, it can be quite tense, and the crowd are literally we're on the crowd lap, literally.
Most of the time, actually.
Yeah, well, there have been a few times.
Yeah.
I think that's what makes the shows at the units, is having that, being so close to what's going on, and the atmosphere in there, when that place is packed, it's pretty awesome to be out there. It's a small crowd. It's brilliant. I think I'm more nervous going out in front of the smaller crowd at RI than I was going out into the hundreds at SWE at the weekend. I don't know why. I think it's because there's probably less people than more. I don't know.
Well, all the faces can kind of merge together. Yeah, again, we get bigger crowds, like they kind of all merge together. But the one thing I noticed from your shows, from the YouTube videos anyway. Yeah, it is quite a smaller crowd, but it's probably louder than most crowds I've heard at shows I've been to in like smaller venues, like your community centres or things like that, which again is testament to your
crowd. I've been told by a few people that, you know, that do blogs and things like that, where that they're going around looking at a lot of the shows, and they're saying, you know, that show, for all there was this guy to come and that drew a crowd, you know, they'd sit in utter silence for the whole thing. So, and you know, when we were doing, example of 2 weeks ago, we're doing a Sunday Slam show, which is exclusively a trainee show,
yeah,
and it's drawn just as well, nearly as much as one of our main shows
from the unit, yeah.
Which, you know, there's guys coming in from SWE, there's guys coming in from ICW, from SWA, and like they're bringing a crowd with them. When people have came to see our trainees, it's like, well, must be doing something right, yeah.
Yeah, and, well, you've also got that as well, and over the top, you've got your 20-man, it was a 20-man?
Well, yeah, now 30-man, we've got a few surprises lined up.
30 now, right, okay, I've got to change my preview, which is on oswtv.wordpress.com for ones listening to the podcast. So we've got the 30-man rumble, so that's quite a lot of guys you've got coming into the Scout Hall. So it'll be a lot more, I'm guessing, than your regulars and your trainees. How hard was it to source guys to come to Reckless Tent, or was there guys contacting you to get involved, or?
A little bit of both. At first, this is where it gets a little bit sketchy with stories, but yeah. I'll call it bullshit.
You see the shit word again.
Pretty much, we're not considered a credible company by some, and some workers are pretty much told, if you work for them, you're not going to work for us.
This is the nonsense
we're kind of faced with. So, like, there's been times I could contact someone for a booking and pretty much just get ignored, pretty much because they're under instruction that they're not allowed to work for, or not necessarily instruction, under threat, per se.
Yeah,
under threat. Like, they're told, if you work for us, you'll not get booked for this company, you'll not get booked for them. We get the, who are they guys? Those guys are not trained, they're dangerous, they only know, we get all this bullshit and nonsense. Which I think is more of a testament at the person who claims we're not trained, given that he was the one that trained us.
Yeah, there's been a lot of, like, rumours and bullshit spread about us by someone.
And it's not deniable stuff, because, like, we've actually physically seen the emails that have been sent to workers, to booking agencies, to the local government. These things are all coming to us from the people that are receiving them and saying, look, this guy's saying this about you. I know it's not true. How would you like me to respond? But, I mean, not just all of that. I mean, from the very, very starting point, we were led to believe, for Reckless Intent's formation, yeah, we were led to believe that we were blacklisted from Scottish Wrestling. We were told by our trainer, the person we worked for originally, that we were blacklisted from Scottish Wrestling, that he had associations with every wrestling promoter and booker in Scotland, and he would see to it that we never work in Scotland again. And that, 100% honesty, is the only reason Reckless Intent even started, because those of us that were there at the start, I think it started with approximately 5 of us, and that eventually grew to 9,
yeah.
All of which there's only 2 of us left, through trial and error and whatnot. But it was the passion that we still had to want to do it, to want to train, to want to learn, to want to perform, you know. At first, there's a horrible thing where you just kind of stop and you fall out of love with wrestling for a while. But eventually, you know, when you do this, it doesn't leave you. You always want to return to it. So it was that passion of wanting to do it that made us even start Reckless Intent.
I started.
Well, we all did. We were all there at the beginning.
I was the guy that had the responsibility of taking the step and
making it an official business and getting the, going ahead and applying to the Prince's Trust and getting the funding, and it's like
there was two, but one guy didn't pull his weight.
Yeah, there was two of us to start with, but he didn't pull his weight, and then
blamed everybody else
for not him not pulling his weight, and then when we got the Prince's Trust money, like tried to return the money to the Prince's Trust, but
we're having a ring man.
We've just had Phil Powers has started making the ring. And we're like, great, the Prince's Trust money will be through in a couple of days, we'll get the payment sent off quickly. And as the payment came in, I got a phone call from the Prince's Trust saying that the person who I was like my business partner at the time was trying to return the money, and I was like, you can't do this, we've just made a commitment, this guy's bought us a wrestling ring, we've got to pay him now. Eventually I had to end up paying $2,000 out of my own pocket to get this guy out. That's how much getting him out of the company cost me, with $2,000 to get rid of him. Even though he'd signed all the paperwork, made all the commitments, and there was always a risk this was going to go tits up. But we were adults, we've made that commitment, we've got this responsibility on our shoulders. But obviously he wasn't willing to commit to it, and here we are now. I spent $2,000 out of my own pocket and got rid of him, bought his share of the company, paid off his debt and got rid of him, and now here we are now, nearly 2 years later since then. So I kind of got to that point, knowing all that information, you know, about being told we were blacklisted and things like that, about eventually just I think it was Mikey that made the push, but to start speaking to people and contacting people, and these people, like people that before we were led to believe, you know, would never speak to us, would never look at us, all sit and watch our footage and laugh. This is all the kind of information that we were told.
We spent 2013 pretty much hidden away. We just, it wasn't a bad thing that we spent hidden away, because that gave us that 12 months to sit, really get to work, and get ourselves a lot better than what we actually were. And then kind of 2014's kind of been the launch pad for us. Big credit, Dave Lowe at SWE for kind of welcoming us and giving us a chance. Joe Hendry's been great as well, has opening doors and helped me kind of talk to other people as well. Scott Rennick as well, has been brilliant since he came on board with us. There's a lot of guys, probably far too many to name, who have been really good to us and helped us. There was a few clues from the very get-go with people such as Darren Lewis, who had contacted us at the early stages, and we at the time still felt that we were being worked, and this was a kind of a trap for someone to get into us and think that. You know, we wouldn't publicise the address, and though we were receiving emails and Facebook messages from other Scottish workers, you know, we wouldn't even entertain the concept of replying to them and stuff.
You unfortunately got burnt by past experiences. That's the worst thing. That's actually worse in the wrestling business. I mean, I'm just saying as an outside source, but being worked, when you start speaking to someone, you don't know what's real and what's fake, and I think, well, you guys, it was even worse for you guys, because you had the bad experiences with this trainer, and
she opened up our unit. We tried our hardest to keep our location of where we were actually based top secret.
Which may have hurt our original audience.
It may have hurt us originally. When we had trainees contacting us to come to meet training, we were so paranoid about giving the address away, because we genuinely thought we were going to turn up one day and find that the unit had been broken into and burned out. That was genuinely how we felt.
And don't get me wrong, we're 100% fully insured and stuff like that, so due to the
hostility that certain people have towards us, we genuinely thought that place was getting broken into and burned out. So we tried to keep where we were top secret. You know, so people were contacting us, new trainees contacting us, I want to learn how to wrestle, and, you know, and I'm having to go through a screening process with them where I'm phoning them and having an hour-long conversation and arranging to meet them in a unbiased location on the next day, and then speaking to them in person, and then eventually inviting them to a training session to try it out.
A lot of that is our own, was our own insecurities at the time.
No, I said
we didn't know where we stood with the rest of the Scottish wrestling scene. Don't get me wrong, like last year's product was shit. It was awful. It was just garbage. There's not very much of last year's product up on YouTube anymore. Because I think where the product is now compared to last year, we're just a completely different level. I think we had to go through the negativity of last year to get to where we are in a more positive place this year. Don't get me wrong, there's been a few. There's been a few shitstorms happen this year, but the bad things have happened. We've had a lot of good things happen for us guys as well. So the good outweighs the bad, I guess.
Well, exactly. Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's all the negativity that you thought you had, I suppose, made you guys more determined to actually make it a success.
For certain. You know, in a lot of circumstances, we still don't know where we stand with some people in some companies because that we haven't crossed that bridge yet. But you know, the recent events and stuff like that has us questioning if that, you know, a lot of what we've been told isn't in fact true. You know, so it is what it is. And we're just more interested in focusing on what we're doing. And continuing to get their representation profile up, and try to get our guys out there as well, because I think we've got quite a few guys that have got a lot of potential, and can add a lot to the scene. Yeah, I've always been of the opinion that the only way, you know, one of the best and easiest ways to get better is to work with people better than you, and that's all fine and good if they continually work with the people that are training them. But to really gain new perspectives, you have to work with new people to learn new experiences.
Yeah.
And the thing of it is, like, these guys are ready to step up there and do it. Guys like St. George, Zachy, Davey, Venom, these guys are ready to get out there and do it. Yeah. But
the Russell brothers in there as well. Those two have a lot of potential.
Highly a lot, actually.
In ring ability and personality-wise, there's so much to come from those two. I'm looking forward to really getting them back in training and seeing where things go from over the next 12 months or so, because I reckon they two could be the guys that break out in the next year.
If
Russell brothers,
if in fact Wild Wild West doesn't become the next Grado first.
Wild Wild West is a character.
So I mean, I suppose the paranoia also stemmed to your trainees. You won't know if they can be accepted in other companies because they may have the stigma of coming.
However, the way that I have trained them and taught them is to not take, you know, it's not making mistakes that necessarily I've made. You know, it's a kind of do as I say, not as I do kind of situation. I want them to send their resumes to everybody. I want them to try and learn from everybody, you know, to really get themselves out there. If they come to me and say they've been booked by or they've been asked to come and do a session by, you know, one of the people, I will be incredibly wary about it, but I will actually physically take them to it as well.
Yeah.
You know,
there's one thing when we were training at the place where we trained.
Oh yeah, when we were told we weren't allowed.
We were pretty much told, this is where you train, this is the only place you're going to train,
this is the only place you'll ever work,
this is the only place that you're going to work for. There were no opportunities given to us at all.
Don't get me wrong, there was guys booked in from the outside that you would work with, but there was no possibility of working anywhere
else. Yeah, we were pretty much told, this is the only place you should want to work. Why would you want to work for anybody else? The guy, he was full of shit. That's pretty much the nicest way to put it. Full of bullshit. But like with our trainees, we took a completely different approach, and we're like, go and train with him, go and train with as many people as possible, go to Glasgow, train in the schools in Glasgow, go to Dundee, train in Dundee, We've even been down at PCW and done
the, yeah, we
went down to the seminar down there with Chris Hero, which was a great experience as well. So like, our trainees are encouraged to go as many places as possible and learn.
Yeah, I personally bought another car so I could ferry these guys around the country to do it, because there seems to be a curse with Scottish wrestling where nobody drives.
Nobody has a driving license.
So
to be on the road.
That kind of speaks for itself, in that, you know, our trainees from whatever age up to whatever age, you know, not all of them can drive. So me being the responsible adult and the trainer. Let's get them to these places. Let's not, you know,
have them miss out on
the stuff. So because of that, you know, I'll take myself and another four guys to a seminar that's happening in Dundee, or, you know, Mikey took, how many did you take up the other day? Three?
Yeah.
Three up to Brian Kendrick's seminar. So that's just kind of the kind of things we do because we're wonderful guys.
Yeah, we go that extra mile to make sure the trainees get their opportunities.
That's great stuff. And you also, as you were talking about bringing in guys as well, one name that comes to mind about someone who I'm sure these guys could learn a lot from is Aspen Faith, who himself hasn't been wrestling that long, but you got a guy that can do very much the technical, submission based, but can do a bit of everything. And he comes in, was that... I mean, I'm sure he was brought in as a guy that could have a good match with someone. But when you bring in guys from up my way, I suppose, Aberdeenshire area, I suppose you always learn a little bit something from everyone, basically. For who,
yeah, could, there's always something to learn from like everybody. It's encouraged people not to be ignorant and only listen to what one person says, because there's so much to come.
No, for sure.
Everybody's got something to offer. I mean, that's why we have four trainers as well as Mikey, because, you know, we all have a difference of opinion about how and why something should be done. We all have things that we're better at than the others, you know?
Yeah.
You know, if someone wants to know how to do some form of head scissor, hurricanrana, say, blah, 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 talk to Falcon, because not one of us can do that. You know? So it's kind of... that there's that difference of opinion available at that level. But, you know, absolutely, I want my guys to get around and learn everywhere and get their name everything.
Yeah. Last Saturday at SWE, it was for me and Sean to see me, him, Venom and Jackie all on an SWE card and winning such a big show. It shows how far Reckless Intent came. That's my guys on there. So for me, it's quite a proud moment to see all four of us on there together in the same match.
Absolutely. I mean, I'll be honest. I never heard of you guys until about when was it? Must have been May. No, it wasn't May. It was April. It was April this year, actually, so it has just shown. Well, anyway, I actually only noticed as soon as I came into the venue, I think there must have been about 4 or 5 years, all in the Reckless Intent t-shirts. And for a lot of the
match... That's actually a misnomer. I just want to like, correct that while we're here. The black and yellow t-shirts are actually the Reckless Intent originals.
Yeah,
t-shirts.
Alright, like, okay.
A lot of people wear these t-shirts thinking they're supporting Reckless Intent. They're actually not. They're just supporting me and Mikey.
Yeah, that's our tag team, like, t-shirts.
But there are available, you know, proper Reckless Intent branded t-shirts, though. We start seeing a lot more of them. But, just to connect that, just while we're on the subject.
They still buy the Reckless Intent Originals t-shirts.
Oh, no, by all means, please. Yeah.
Right, but yeah, they're just like big, well, basically like the Nexus ones, but with, it was big, bold, and seeing these guys, and for a lot of the event, I was waiting for you guys to jump in, because I've learned
I've been talking about
impression, like before that, we were just like, we need to, like, people to notice us, like, we go up there, nobody knows who we are, we're just these guys turning up,
You know, it's actually a story that has been pitched to me twice
by other bookers, thinking about pushing this story of an invasion kind of angle, and you know, you're like, yeah, let's do it, and then it kind of never happens for whatever reason. But
you bend. It's best for business, though.
It is. I was told a story recently as well where one or two of my guys were doing security somewhere, and eyes were on my guys, expecting them to jump in the ring and do something because they're recognised.
Yeah.
You know, I was told that recently someone was watching St. George for almost an entire show, expecting him at any point to jump in the ring. It never happened because St. George just did his job and did security, so...
I was just imagining someone just sitting there going, go on, George. Go on. No.
On that show, it's funny. The only St. George... they disappeared to fix the ring apron, and at that opportunity, some little fathead ran right through the barriers and into the ring with Johnny Lyons and Andy Wild. It was hilarious.
Damn it, George. I'm guessing that was that Discovery then, would have been.
That kid was the happiest kid in the world. He got in that ring. Although he nearly hung himself trying to get out because he like slid out the ring and then popped up and the bottom rope, his head got caught in the bottom rope.
See, everyone forgets about that. I've only had the opportunity to get in there a couple of times for SWE, and your body is a lot longer than you think it is.
Yeah. There's a certain skill to it. He's running the ropes at training, and he hit the rope, and then he must have slid through the middle rope. And his head went through, and as he stood up to compose himself again, he was on the other side of the rope, and then went to run and completely pinned himself back onto the middle rope because he got hung up on it. It's funny, really funny.
Bit safe though, but.
Oh, well, like, yeah. And he fell through the rope, so it was quite funny. You get these things at training.
But so with the trainees then, so how many trainees do you have on a regular basis coming through the unit?
It depends what night of the week you're on. We try to let it run sessions as often as possible. We have four main sessions a week, and all trainers are available to be booked on a one-on-one basis. You will find we're in there more often than that. It just depends what night of the week you come, you know.
We have the 25 trainees. Not all of them come all at once.
But on the books, and there's kind of ones that come in and out that, you know, we're coming regularly.
And then take a few months off.
Something in their life's troubling or whatever.
So between 25 and 30 guys, kind of training on and off. Regular-wise, we've got about
regular. You pretty much walk at any session and they're in the same 15 are there. Which are clearly the ones that want to advance, that want to do it, that are taking full advantage of, you know, the pricing scheme and the facility that's there before them.
Because as well as having the ring, we've got gym in our training school as well, so the guys have got the opportunity as well as get in the ring and train. They've got the opportunity to weight train, and work on their physique and bodies as well.
So that was actually my next question. Is like, out of all them, is there a clear set of guys that are wanting to be wrestlers, or ones that are just giving it a go and testing the waters, maybe not coming back because it's not for them? But you've actually answered my next question.
I pretty much really me and Sean encourage them to come everywhere with us. So, like most places you'll see us, we'll have the same group of guys with us because we encourage them to come with us and get their names out. They're the guys that want to kind of progress more in wrestling, the ones that we take everywhere, as well as Wee Jimmy. He comes everywhere with us.
Wee Jimmy comes everywhere with us.
He is furniture.
But you know, that there are ones that really that take advantage of the fact that, you know, when we're coming around, even if they're not doing anything, guys like Rob Miller, he's not necessarily doing anything in the place that we're going, but he'll come anyway.
Yeah.
Well, this is all experience. I mean, for being backstage at shows, you I mean, you might not be doing anything, but you're still there to learn.
If our guys, if any of our trainees, well, we would always ask our trainees to be there for a start, but if our trainees are there, they'll have something to do, whether it's double-clicking a song when it's time to come out, or pressing the record button on the camera, and holding it steady and not watching the match with their eyes, watching the match with the camera.
Bad camera, man. We get them.
Yeah, we've had them all, actually. Yeah. Every single possible one.
Yeah, that's true.
That's true.
Alright, I've asked quite a lot of things that I thought I was going to. Is there anything you guys wanted to speak about specifically that we can speak about while we've got a platform?
I think we've covered quite a lot of things.
I wanted to talk about, over the top and just kind of get that out there. That we're doing that and it's going to be a big deal and
looking forward to it. This has been 2 years in the making for Over the Top. So for this venue, as I say, that was like the one that we pinpointed. Like, I was brought up in the area of Muriston for the last 12-13 years. So that's where I grew up, to see the Scout Hall and know that, like, I'm taking the company that I've been building for the last 2 years to this place, for the local community there. Like, it's a big thing for me. I am really, really nervous. Not about having my match or anything, but like in terms of like being the promoter and the guy running the show, I'm really, really nervous. And I just want it all to just go nice and smoothly. I'm sure it will, but it still doesn't stop you having the nerves before the show, I guess.
Okay, so we'll go for the final link to tell everyone that's listening. Hopefully the millions and millions. What to expect at Over the Top, when it is, how to get there, just everything, go for it.
Okay, well, Reckless Intent presents Over the Top on Saturday the 1st of November. It will be in Muriston Scout Hall, which is in Livingston. What's the postcode?
We
made up a directions on the website because it is a new venue, so we thought it would help people find it. So the postcode is EH549LE, and you can find that information on reckless-intent.com/directions, and that will show you how to get to Muriston Scout Hall. Sean?
Now, as for the show itself, I have an idea about who these Sons of Silence guys that are kicking around are, and certainly I have an idea who one of them is, and that's the reason why I've chosen to wrestle Falcon, because I honestly believe a guy that hides under a mask, with a penchant for comic books, to be one of these Sons of Silence, and I'm going to find out for myself on Saturday.
Who are you wrestling?
Who's that guy? What's his name?
Global Bacon.
On Saturday I'm defending the Reckless Intent UK title against the global hero Joe Hendry. It's going to be the second time I've wrestled Joe, but I think a lot's changed since we first wrestled back in May. Especially since I've been getting attacked by the Sons of Silence since May. I actually have a suspicion that Joe Hendry might actually be involved in the Sons of Silence.
There is a big one.
Yeah, there is a big one and resembles Joe's height and bald. So
that's a good point.
I think I might just have to kick Joe extra hard in the head and hope that his Sons of Silent brothers don't come out and
there's a little one, a medium size and a big one. Yep. So
I think Vulcan's a little.
I'm looking forward to the match with Joe. He's a very, very talented guy. I'm having impressive matches like pretty much everywhere he goes. Joe's getting a lot of eyes on him. So Saturday, I'm looking forward to retaining my Rex and 10 UK title.
Yeah.
Yes. Also on the card, you will see, working your way from top to bottom, there's a six-man elimination match for positions in the Rumble, with the winner coming into the Rumble absolutely last. So far, that six-man elimination match features
Blackie Grady,
Venom, JJ Russell, and AJ Russell.
who will be looking to settle up this rivalry they've had going with each other, this brotherly love thing. So
there are two empty slots in that match.
Two vacant wildcard spots, which General Manager Jason McKinley is going to announce two participants in that match on Saturday at the show. I have a little idea of who, of one of the people who's going to bring it in. One person who had a very, very impressive match at SWE last weekend, that's one guy that's going to be in that match. I'll not say too much more.
I thought Joe Hendry was already wrestling you. Is he in that match as well?
Possibly. Also on the card, we're going to have SWE champion Ian Ambrose versus Bobby Roberts, who's recently been promoted to a sergeant. He must have done some good work to get promoted 3 ranks in a couple of weeks. That's good work for Bobby.
Anything is possible in the world of wrestling, Ron.
I think he debuted as a sergeant at Rock and Wrestle up in Strathpeffer, so he must have earned it while he was on the way there.
Road rules, yeah. We're going to see the briefcase holder, the superstar Dan Lewis versus Craig Valiant. Craig's an up-and-comer that we picked up from a Fife training school that wasn't really training at straight A's, and Craig came to us looking to continue his training. We're more than happy to, you know, oblige him, and since then Craig's really been coming. He's had some wins, some losses, so it'll be a true test of his strength to go up against someone so much bigger and so much stronger.
Yeah,
and with everything that Darren has had behind him as well.
Yeah, let's not forget how good Darren actually is.
I
don't know how many people actually know this, but Darren Lewis was actually one of the first guys from Scotland to get a WWE tryout.
One of the first in the UK, actually.
I think he's one of the first to get it back in 2005, I think. I'm not entirely sure. I'm sure he was one of the first guys from Scotland to get a WWE tryout.
I think he answered that in my Q&A on the OSWtv website. Yeah. So everyone should be going to read that. Definitely. Yeah.
There's quite a few of the representing guys have got Q&As up there. What other matches have we got? We have the Wrexham World Title match, Scott Rennick versus Steve
Don't
George.
Forget about that. The Chris Duke happily had these guys on his radio station. Did you listen to that, Billy?
I didn't get a chance. However, I have heard that it was quite an interesting listen.
It was hilarious.
Two callers.
Chris Duke said he'd never had that before.
Didn't know what body press.
That was actually a really funny interview, having them on for that 1 hour.
Some guy called Mark called in as well.
But pretty much the stipulation is for the world title match. St. George cheats, gets counted out.
Which he will. He'll try one of those games.
He will lose the title, and General Manager Jason McKinley will be firing St. George on the spot. And Scott Rennick will win the Wrexham 10 world title if that happens.
St. George actually cheated me out of the world title by stealing it and then stealing my rematch clause. And I've already wrestled Scott and he won, but I feel like I held him down for a good 5 count.
Yeah.
So I'd be interested to wrestle Scott again if he wins.
Well, at least George has got security as a backup career, so it's okay.
But that's it, yeah. St. George has always got a thing career to go out to. Maybe someone will help him get his SIA license for the next time.
And of course, the
man over the top rope, the top rumble.
Well, not to be forgotten about the Sons of Silence who've kind of been.
Will they show up on Saturday?
Keep on trying to, you know, take over things with Sam Crowe, the leader of the Sons of Silence, recently stealing the hardcore title from Wild Westie.
Poor Westie. He brought his fan base across to Sunday Slam. They all thought he'd won the hardcore title, and then he's out there.
I actually heard that there was actually a child crying.
When Westie got beat.
Will the Sons of Silence turn up over the top? It's going to be our biggest show this year.
Well, we'll see if we're right about
so the people beat who we think are.
My money's on Joe Hendry being the Sons of Silence.
No, I'm not Falcon. It's one of them small. It's got to be.
What do you think, Billy? Who's in the masks?
I think I've got a fair idea now that you're mentioning big, medium and small. I think I've got an idea who might be under the masks, but I don't want to spoil it on podcast. Just in case I'm right, I'll let you guys rip their masks off and reveal all.
Yeah, the
that's one thing that came out of Sunday Slam is that the originals are back to kick some ass. We're not 100% on the same page because, you know, he doesn't believe it's Falcon and I do and I'm gonna fend it for myself, so.
Alright, so I think well, we're speaking for about just 55 minutes now. I think we'll start wrapping up. So, Over the Top, November 1st, it's going to be a huge show at the Scout Hall in Mewerston. How much are the tickets?
Adults is £10, concessions £5, and family ticket, 2 adults, 2 kids, is £25.
When's the first bell?
The first bell, we've got doors opening at 6, first bell is at 6:30. However, if it is very busy at 6:30, we will make a decision to delay it by 15 minutes or half an hour, depending on how many people are still coming in at the time. So we've kind of got a half hour window for the first bell, depending on how many people are still turning up. Because our normal show times are 6:30, doors open, 7:00 is the first bell. A lot of them might still be thinking that that's the case, so we'll call it. We're opening doors at 6 anyway, so people will have time to get in early, get some refreshments and get comfortable and get a seat.
The reckless intent divas that I've been seeing on Facebook.
I hope more than one of them on the day though, so yeah. You know, more than Jackie Grady, of course. You can't see this, I'm shaking my head right now.
Perfect.
Not to be forgotten, the main event of that show is the Over the Top 30-man Rumble, and the winner of this match will get a number one contender's title shot next year on the first night of the Super Bowl, which is our 2-day tournament to establish the best wrestler in West Lothian.
I think that's if I'm going to get down to any show next year, that's going to be the ones I'm going to try and get down to, the two-night Super Bowl.
Nice.
Two nights of big wrestling. What more can you ask for?
Perfect. A few surprises lined up for that one as well. Yeah, and also to remember as well that the history of the Super Bowl, it was won by Scott Rennick, who is your number one contender on Saturday this past year. Scott Rennick won the Super Bowl trophy, so and now he's number one contender. He's potentially about to take that world title from St. George.
And hopefully everyone will be there to find out. I'll be glued to Twitter or Facebook, just trying to find out as much as I can.
There should be, during the show on Saturday, we're going to have live updates.
Yeah, live updates on Facebook.
Live updates on Facebook during the show as it's happening. So stay tuned. They will be on Facebook throughout the show, letting people know what's happening.
Excellent. I think that's about it. We've got any shout-outs at all before we wrap up?
You can follow me on Twitter, which is... how does the Twitter thing work? Is it at Rawlins is for real?
Is that the number 4?
Yes, yeah. 4. Sorry, yes. I kind of nod towards where I get my inspiration, where I've had my inspiration from.
Yes,
and just ask people follow us on Facebook, Reckless Intent Wrestling. Check out the website reckless-intent.com, and look at the training school, the West Lothian Pro Wrestling School, and if you're interested in a birthday party in the West Lothian or the Lothians area, we have West Lothian birthday parties on Facebook as well, so give that check that out and give it a like.
Perfect.
Great, thanks for taking the time to talk to us, brother. We really appreciate that.
No problem at all.
Person soon.
Yep, you will. You definitely will see me soon.